And one of our favorite bands from the 60s is called the Cowsills. Recently, we watched a documentary on Netflix, I believe, and it was a really good movie called Family Band, The Cowsills Story. And about 2 minutes when that was over, 2 minutes after it was over, I decided to reach out and get on internet and find Bob Cowsill, and I was able to do that. And I got to say, Bob was on it. And about an hour later, he said, yeah, I'd love to come on the Church of Rock. And he was extremely friendly. And he's on the phone right now. Hey, Bob Cowsill.
Well, hello, everybody. Yeah, of course. I was happy to hear from you.
Awesome.
You know, it gets a little lonely these days, right?
Oh, gosh, right? What was your opinion of the documentary, Bob?
Well, it was, as we did it, it was rather difficult because documentaries by nature are sort of psychiatric sessions you have with your family and your story.
Right.
So it was a little rough. We did shut it down for a couple of years even to think, you know, this is what we want to do. And then when we were done with it, and thank you, Louise Palanker and Bill Filipiak, who edited it, it was Showtime who picked it up for 2 years. They played this thing like on all their Showtime channels 4 or 5 times a day. It really struck a nerve with everybody. And that's when you learn really about what you may have done or not done. If what you did strikes a nerve with everybody else, well, that was your good news, because clearly you're doing something that strikes a nerve with you.
Yeah. Amen.
But, yeah. Whether people or the public can connect with what you're telling them, you're not going to find that out till later. And so that was good news to us, and we were very grateful for it.
Hey, Bob, I know the Cowsills were originally from, I believe, Newport, Rhode Island. Is that where you still reside?
No, the world expanded for our family, and we are now between Oregon, Oregon, New Orleans, California, Rhode Island, Illinois, and Texas.
Wow!
Wow! Really?
But we did start in Newport, Rhode Island. Back then, it was a Navy town. Our dad was stationed there in the Navy, and that's why we were there. And it was a great place to grow up, Middletown High School, and having that island. It was about 3 miles by 12 miles, and you had bicycles, and it was the early 60s, and it was a different world back then, and you just went out on your bike and stayed out all day and came back when the street light came on.
Yeah, I remember.
It was that simple. No one was checking on you, and just don't be late when the street light comes.
Right.
I remember.
That was your big issue. That was your big issue. Oh, my God.
And your brother Paul is a farmer in Oregon. Is that correct?
I call him a rancher. I say west of the Mississippi is a ranch, east is a farm.
Yeah,
but he is a hay farmer. He has hay for the horses and lives in Madras, Oregon, which is, I mean, it's in the middle of, like, you don't want to have to go get a quart of milk.
No.
Okay. You gotta
a lot of places that like that in Oregon.
There you go. And look, the people that love them, but I need to be closer to the milk and bread.
Yeah.
But Paul loves it and loves the life of being there. And Susan loves New Orleans and the crazy kind of off-center place it is. So we're all spread out and happy where we are.
That's so cool. I like your sister, Susan. She's always been so cute. She's just so awesome.
Thank God for a sister. I mean, one sister could balance out 6 brothers. It was the most amazing thing to experience. I'm telling you, I would need 6 sisters to balance us out. But as Susan came along, she was the last one of the 7. And as soon as she dropped in, it all evened out, you know, and everyone started probably behaving as young boys. And we got a little sister now. And, you know, it was great when she came on board.
I got a question about songwriting, a brief question. When you guys wrote so many beautiful songs and lots of hit songs, did you or was somebody else that took the lead with lyric writing, or was it something that was shared?
Well, it was shared, but really, I personally am a melody guy. I get melodies and melodies, and then I look at lyrics as an assignment. Like, well, no one's going to just accept a melody. I'm going to have to say something. And that's when I go to, like, Susan and Paul are great lyricists. They can fire these things off, and which makes me a better lyricist. So between us, we've been writing this next piece of work we have coming out. We've been writing together as a threesome. And, yeah, the lyricists are Susan and Paul, and Susan along with me are the melody people because we write music and stuff, but we just make it up. We can't read or write music. It's not like we plot it out.
Yeah.
You just take, you know, you get a song going in your head and you like I say, you got to say something now. But Susan is the type that walks around with all these books of lyrics, and she's got things to say all the time.
Thank goodness.
All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The gold.
Yeah, you know it.
You were just mentioning the project you guys have coming up. Can you tell us about that?
We've been in the studio just before the pandemic hit. We were just finished recording 20 songs, 9 of them a cappella, for a project called Rhythm of the World, which is a song Susan wrote, which we love the title of. So Rhythm of the World is a 20-song collection, 11 new songs, 9 a cappella, and about 6 to 8 hidden tracks, but bonus tracks of things from our past that people may not have heard from us before. And we'll take this opportunity to reintroduce those. And then we have a podcast, the Councils podcast we're working on. It should go live in about a month or two at the most. And so we're going to enter the podcast world because we have so much to say.
That's exciting.
It's going to be very exciting. We've been mixing all the songs to Rhythm of the World remotely with this guy, Frank Filippetti, our mix engineer in Connecticut, and reinventing how to mix. And we're just going back and forth remotely and just finishing it up, and then it gets mastered in December. Everybody from nobody to Taylor Swift twice are dropping their new music. So we hope that by the time we're there with ours, all these people have dropped all theirs.
Yeah.
And people, it'll leave a big gap where we can come out, hey, by the way, we're here to reclaim our legacy.
Yeah, eliminate the competition.
Yeah, it'll be fun. So, you know, sometime next year, and look, the COVID timeline is everybody's timeline. No one's racing ahead of anybody. So yeah. We'll be ready when it's time and be able to get all this out and have a great 2021.
Yes.
We have a great executive producer, Rock Positano. He's our guy. He keeps the project going when, you know, the pandemic or anything else wants to slow it down. We got a real good team on this. So we're going to have a really good shot, and we're really fortunate to have it coming at us.
That's awesome. And, you know, for those tuning in, you're listening to an interview with Bob Cowsill from the legendary Cowsills here at KSKQ Radio. And for those who might not know, just for the sake of fun pop culture trivia, the Cowsills are the family that inspired the television show The Partridge Family. And I mean inspired on a direct level.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a straight lateral. I mean, they came to our house in Santa Monica to visit us because they thought we could be the kids in the TV show. But we were older and not good actors. And, well, we probably could have done it. What do we know? Anyway, they went with Central Casting. And it was a honor. And we were very flattered that our story was literally good enough for a positive, fun television series that lasted and kept our name alive, quite frankly, at a time where our star was fading. So the Partridge Family kept us in the news through their whole run, and we talk about them now. So it's been a wonderful relationship.
Yeah, and it's cool that the mother, Shirley Jones, introduced your band at the 2004 benefit concert for Bill.
Yeah, we had our brother Billy, who's passed away, but he was sick at the time. We did a benefit concert for him, and that's when we met Shirley Jones, and it was so great meeting her and hearing how the Partridge Family experience was as compared to ours, and we got to share stories, and she has been very gracious in our documentary and filled us in on a lot of what it was like on her set of the Partridge Family. So that was a fun relationship to pursue.
And for those listening that were back in the 70s watching television as we were, if you didn't know, the Cowsills were the band behind the television show Love American Style.
Oh, yeah, we got to, you know, it's funny, when you have hits and you're kind of famous, which we were, you know, I mean, we were,
obviously,
and,
yeah.
And you're kind of living the life of recording and touring, these are little assignments that come to you at that. So I'm like 19 years old, 20 years old, and they say, hey, come in and do this song, Love American Style, and they go, what for? Oh, for a TV show. Okay, well, you know, not walking around at 19 wondering if their TV show is going to be a hit. So you just go in and you record this song, you know, and you get back to your life. But Love American Style comes out. It's a great show. It really took off. It's fun to watch. And for the first year, we had the theme song. We perform it live now in our shows because we never did. Back then, it was just like a homework assignment. Okay, I got that done. And they go, oh, it was a hit. A hit TV show. How cool, you know?
Wow.
And now years later, people don't know that we did that, so we can pull it out in our show, and they go, oh my God, they did that too.
What a cool song, and what a great show that really was. It was so fun and crazy. I loved it.
Yeah, it was great. It was a good show, fun.
What
early vignettes.
Other than that, what are a couple of your favorite Cowsill classics, or any songs that you might have done, even B-sides? Do you have any favorites?
Well, we have, you know, my favorite oldie is the Rain the Park and Other Things, only because you remember the studio, you remember walking in, you remember seeing an orchestra basically with a harp and a conductor, Jimmy Wisner, who'd arranged the track. And we're like 17-year-olds, 18-year-olds, 10, 14, 15, and we're looking out there going, "Where? How are we going to put that on stage?" You know, but you go out, you do your vocal arrangement, and you worry about that later. We built our sound in the studio as opposed to longer range bands who work it out on the road and get tight, and then they go into the studio. We didn't do it that way. So we took from the studio to the stage, and we pulled it off. It was okay, even with harps and violins and stuff, because our focus was vocals, always has been vocals, using them as instruments, using them a lot. And in our new Rhythm of the World, we do a lot. Well, we have 9 acapellas, so there you go. We do a lot of vocals. Wow. So that being our focus, we could really reproduce well on stage, just no matter the tracks.
That's interesting. 9 acapellas. Wow.
Yeah, we took, but we did do our old hits. These aren't new songs. The 11 songs are new. The old, the 9 acapellas are the Rain, the Park, and Other Things, Hair, and Indian Lake, Love American Style. We did 9 acapellas of our old hits, 2x2, Impossible Years, which is a movie theme song we did. So we redid those like Glee meets Perfect Pitch.
You know? Wow.
You'll see.
Yeah.
They're not just acoustic versions. These things are like acapella. But it was fun to stretch the vocals that way.
I did like the sample that you sent me, and I think Sister Tracy has a question for you.
Well, okay. I you know, we were saying how we wanted to talk a lot about what you're doing now, but I know you guys were asked to record the song Hair, to re-record that, and I was just doing some reading about all that went into that recording session. Can you tell us a little bit about that, like how it came about? And
yeah, we were at our house in Santa Monica. It was 1968. We had gotten a package from Lee Mendelsohn Productions from Carl Reiner, who was an old comedian, Rob Reiner's dad. And they were inviting us to do a TV special in San Francisco at the end of our summer tour of 68. So we'll be in San Francisco in like September. So they sent us this Broadway musical album. We hadn't heard of it yet. You know, we're just knucklehead teenagers. You know, what's this? And so he says, we want you to take the theme song Hair and do something you could lip sync to on the TV special. Because back then you had to lip sync because TV didn't know how to handle your live, so it wasn't a negative, it was a positive. And so we heard the song, we thought, well, that's cool, this is a Broadway musical version. And we booked a studio for 2 days down on Fairfax with Angel was our engineer, and in 2 days we recorded the record Hair. There was no pressure. There was no one from MGM there. Mom and Dad weren't there. Mom's not even on Hair. Susan is because of the Aunt Spaghetti. We had to get her on there. But anyway, the guys just went down. We rocked it out. And we thought, hey, this is pretty good, you know. And we sent it to Lee Mendelsohn. So we're going to do it on TV. But the special isn't for another, whatever, 8 months or whatever it is. This thing's going to sit in the tank for a while. We sent it to MGM. They didn't like it because we were coming off Indian Lake. And this was certainly not Indian Lake. So where did the councils go was their opinion. And we said, hey, we don't care. So we took it out on the road with us. We had the demo. We were doing an interview on WLS in Chicago, which was like 50,000 watts after midnight.
Oh, yeah.
And we did this interview at night with the DJ. Told him the MGM story, and he thought it was cool, and put it on the radio, see if anyone could guess who it was. No one could, and but it got played and took off from. And this wasn't until May of 69, by the way. This thing sat at the studio waiting for the TV special. And MGM didn't like it anyway. They weren't going to put it out. But when the TV special got close, you could see they realized, they think we have something here. And they coordinated releasing Hair in May of 69. And the special was like a month later or something. So it all clicked. And little did we know that The Fifth Dimension and Three Dog Night and Oliver were in their studios recording other hits that were going to be
wow.
hits for the musical Hair. And then we ended up being on this whole... they were all in the top 10 at the same time, and you never know what's going to happen and why it happens. It's
wow.
the craziest thing.
Yeah, because I saw that, you know, the song, just like you said, was kind of sitting there, and then it got some airplay in Chicago, right? And
what was funny is we were even careful. We knew we were going on TV. Back in those days, you had to be careful because the third verse, you know, My Hair Like Jesus Wore It, we didn't record that verse on the hit record. We just did the first verse over just to not give anyone any agita, you know.
Right, so, keeping it safe.
Yeah, But Armed Forces Radio still banned the recording, by the way. You probably never knew that because of because of the Star Spangled Banner section.
Right.
Can you see my eyes? If you can, then my hair's too short. Well,
God,
we can't have that.
What did you think of What did you think about the Treat Williams? I think it was a 78 or 1980 version of the movie that came out here.
Oh, I've liked every version of anybody's version. I ended up liking the Broadway musical version of
it. Right?
They're all different good versions of a good song, you know.
Agreed.
A great song, man. You know, you can do it this way, you can do it that way. A great, great song, no one wants you to do anything to it. You know, those are the big super songs.
How did it feel back in the day when your first album sold over a million copies? Was that mind-blowing?
Well, it was mind-blowing when the Rain in the Park and other things sold a million copies because that was 67. In 65 and 66, we'd been on two labels, gotten dropped from two labels, had three records out that bombed. So by the time it's the third label, MGM, and it's the Rain in the Park and other things, now at this point, they changed our look because the prior group was the Four Brothers. Now we're going to put Mom. We're going to put Mom in the group to make us look different than every other group, and it did. So now we got Mom and the Rain in the Park and other things. The family, the whole thing took off. I mean, Ed Sullivan loved it. Johnny Carson loved it. Merv Griffin loved it. Mike Douglas loved it. All the TV shows that you needed to depend on in those days, because that's the only way anyone's going to see you, unless they've seen you in concert, was on these variety TV shows. And they liked our band, and we were fortunate for that.
Was it a trip lip-syncing? Was it hard, or did you find it humorous ever to lip-sync, or how'd you do that?
Lip-syncing was a fun challenge. Lip-syncing became, you just wanted to nail it. And the beginning of Hair is no easy matter.
No.
So you just wanted to nail it. And we got very good at lip-syncing. Most of the artists, honestly, back then did get good at lip-syncing. You don't want to look stupid. You know, like the later artists that got caught doing it, and it's such a negative. That lip-syncing world was a whole different lip-syncing world than ours. Heck, man, we had a guy, I think his name is Lloyd Thaxton in L.A., had a lip-syncing contest TV show. So it was viewed as a talent in and of itself back then.
Yeah.
And that way you didn't have to trust the TV stations who had not caught up technologically to record a band with seven voices and five instruments, and here's a song you never heard in your life. Now make it sound great. That was not going to happen.
Yeah, and you're right. You can totally tell when you watch an old show or something where a band performs and they're not good at it. It's just really a bummer, you know.
It's a distraction. You know they're doing it because you're hearing the recording.
Yes.
And back in that day, you wanted people to hear the recording. You know, they're not going to get to your concert, probably. You know,
right.
You're on Ed Sullivan, the country sees you. You hit a tour, they'll see you, but that's all who's going to see you. But yeah, you want it to not be a distraction from what they're listening to, which is your recording, and they get to see the band. Oh, look, that's what they look like. How cool. They know we're not doing it live. Everyone accepted it back then. It was no big deal.
Bob, in your opinion, what were some of the best parts about Fame?
Well, one of the best parts about Fame was feeling validated to some degree personally that, oh, okay, I was right to keep pursuing. Right now, look, we're young kids, we're not going to give up anyway because we're knuckleheads, but even then we're not giving up. We're okay, third label, okay, we're gonna put another record out. I think a lot of it had to do with we were so young that we could just say, oh, we're gonna try it again, okay, let's see, there's another label, another record. That was great. Going on tour and hearing the recording on your first tour on the radio stations all over the country was a special reward. And especially back home in L.A., it was KHJ, and you're home from your tour, and you have the number one record. It's a really unique feeling, not shared by a large part of the population, but the ones who got to experience it, most of us, appreciate it way later in life even more and more, that was a special thing that you pulled off, and it was good to hang in, and that you succeeded was made it more special.
Yeah. Now, I'd like to say congratulations also, Bob, on your 50th anniversary show you guys played in New York City in April of 2015. That's a mighty awesome feat. Now it's been, what, 56 years or something?
Listen, if you would have told us that we'd be putting out a new record, a new podcast, and we're really looking forward to a very vibrant future at our stage in our career, we would have told you were nuts. And back then, we would have sworn that it wouldn't happen because, you know, we're not going to sell out back on do this when we're old. But the older you get, of course, but remember, we're the first generation to keep going with this stuff.
Yeah.
And with the rock and roll. I mean, it was easy for Frank to keep going. These crooners, they could croon till they're 80, 95 years old, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, Tony Bennett got better. But the rock and rollers, I'm amazed at us. And so, and the kids like it because they hear our music. You know what happened. The 60s music was embraced by every subsequent generation. Okay. They know all our songs. We don't know theirs, but they know ours. Wow. So our audiences are full of people who say, hey, I heard your song in Dumb and Dumber because the Rain in the Park and other things. It was in Jim Carrey's
That's
Dumb and
right.
Dumber. Great
yeah.
guy movie. Great guy movie. Played all the time. We have heard the words at our meet and greets after our concerts. Hey, found you on the internet. I go, you did? It's like, this is great. And then, of course, most of our audience is from our generation and the next one. These songs were so good back then that the songs are what carry us today. We carried the songs in the early day. Now they carry us. And it's a wonderful thing. That's how great and awesome they are. This summer tour we do every summer, the Happy Together Tour, with six groups from the 60s. That tour is carried by the songs the six groups are going to sing because we each do four hit records that we had, and it's an amazing group of songs from that era that other eras embrace, and that's why it just makes it all work.
That's so awesome. Thank you so much for all the great years of music. And I think Sister Tracy has a closing question.
Well, I just wanted to point out, we were having a conversation the other day, Derek and I, about how we have seen, like, the first generation, you know, the early rockers from the 50s, aging and getting older. And many of the early guys, you know, Elvis and, you know, people like Jerry Lee mm-hmm. Lewis, Carl Perkins, and how it's so different, how just just being a rocker kind of has a different effect on the way they age. And, you know, it's just like almost like rock and roll keeps them young. You know, we're seeing, it's kind of crazy seeing this generation of the original rockers being older now. It kind of gives you a whole new kind of view of aging in my book.
I agree. Amen. It's not unlike aging itself because, you know, I feel very young, but you look in the mirror, well, clearly.
Okay? Right.
So, yeah. So that's our audience. If you close your eyes, we still sound good. You know,
yeah.
You sound just like those hit records. So you close your eyes, you go, holy mother. You open, you go, holy cow, these guys are old now. Yeah, well, so are you. You
look, know? Right, yeah.
You're looking good, though, Bob. You're looking good, man.
You are.
We're doing okay. We know we're right on the cusp. We're the youngest band. All of our peers, we're all a little older than us. So we're the youth movement of our generation
nice.
Of rock bands.
And
we are.
We're so glad that you made such great music, and we are just big fans. And want to thank you again for making the time to be on the show. And I'd like to take you up on your offer of doing a part two sometime.
Oh, please.
Yeah, we should talk again. You know, when Rhythm of the World is going to come out and the podcast is going, let's chat again. We'll have fun things to talk about.
Oh, that'd be an honor. That'd be great.
We won't be in the pandemic. You know, we'll vaccine out of that. So we should be good.
Okay, well, let's keep in touch. And that'd be an honor, Bob.
Yes, so
all right,
so.
Thanks, Derek and Tracy. Just great talking to all your people. So have a Merry Christmas, everybody.
Thank you so much, Bob. You're awesome.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much, Bob Calso, for the time, and we appreciate your music, and much love to the family.
Love to all of you and your listeners. Bye-bye.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.